Subscribe to Femina and press the bell icon.
The biggest challenge is in the mind, you know, when you believe that you're a woman, when you believe that you're young and you let that stop you. Whatever you're looking for achieving out of that journey, if you're going to focus more on that versus focusing more on the journey, then it'll be hard to break barriers.
She's the new face of Indian fashion and she's been breaking many stereotypes in the fashion industry. Weaving traditional and modern in a fabulous way, she started her own company in 2011. In 2018, she won the prestigious Woolmark International Prize.
And in 2019, she became a part of the Business of Fashion's top 500 list. We have with us today the incredible force behind the brand Bodice, Ruchika Sachdeva, in conversation with Femina. Hi, Ruchika. Thank you so much for being on the show with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Ruchika, Bodice has been creating waves across India and internationally, and you've broken a lot of stereotypes. You don't do fashion shows regularly. Mm. You don't cater to the bridal audiences. Mm. And, you know, you're doing so many different things. But when you started out, what gave you that confidence to do things differently and not follow the norms?
So I obviously started very young. Yeah. And at that time, I didn't want to do something that everybody else was doing. It was honestly basic, you know, it was basic logic that as a designer, as a creative person, what are you adding to the industry? If you're doing the same thing that other people are doing and doing for years, So it wasn't really satisfying for me to do something that's already happening. Mm-hmm. I didn't really look at it as breaking the norms, but I guess for me, it was really about doing something which didn't exist and keeping the women in mind. You know, at that time, there were a lot of working women. Women were starting to question a lot of things. And I didn't think that there was a wardrobe that catered to that, you know. So I was very inspired to create a line for the women who were working, they were busy, they were traveling. They were getting out of the houses. They were much more than just homemakers, you know. So I was quite inspired by their journey and I wanted to create a wardrobe for them.
Okay. But during this journey, do you think that was like the biggest risk you've taken, like not following what the industry standards are?
Of course, it's risky because you're doing something for which the market doesn't exist. It means you really have to do everything from educating to eventually convincing the buyers, wholesale buyers, B2B. Right. That, you know, this is something that's going to be, you know, the need of the hour and it's going to be there. It's going to be very relevant in the future. So when you take such a risk, you also get equal results, right? So eventually we were the first ones to start doing this, which was great. So we almost carved a niche for ourselves.
It's sustainable fashion is like a niche. It's not mass. It's not something that, you know, people are really following in India and internationally as well. One of the factors of that is because it's quite expensive, you know, to produce sustainable clothing. But what do you feel that we can do to make it more mass and take it, you know, so that it's a long-term thing and not just a fashion movement?
So again, sustainability is not like a trend. It's something completely different to a trend. It's a way of living. It's a way of wearing clothes that you know are not going to adversely affect the environment. You can really do small things yourself. And like you said, I think it's a misconception that it's very expensive because money doesn't have much to do with doing the right things for the environment or calculating your carbon footprint. Everybody kind of has a general knowledge what is going to be bad for the earth and what is not. Right. So a lot of sustainable clothing actually comes from waste. So it's really not that expensive. I mean, Bodice is positioned in a certain way where we don't play the number game, right? Which means that we're not selling a lot of pieces. We're not making profit off scale. Mm-hmm. Where our overheads per garment is quite high. That's why it's retailed at a certain price point. Right. But because we're trying to position it as a luxury brand. But I mean, every brand across the world now is starting to have, you know, sustainable options. If you even go to your high street stores, they all are now having lines which are sustainable. So I think it's important as a consumer to educate yourself. Make sure that whatever you buy, you know you're going to keep for a very long time. This whole idea of wearing and throwing and having clothing be disposable is not a great idea. Opening up your mind to renting clothes, opening up your mind to secondhand clothes is something I think we should really encourage everybody to do.
So coming to that, now you are young, you're female, and you're Indian, and I understand those are tags, you know, that you're born with rather than, you know, you chose to do.
Yeah.
But there are so many women across India and designers who really look up to you and, you know, admire the work that you've done.
Hmm.
What do you think were the challenges, given that you were young, Indian and female?
I think conditioning. More than anything, what happens is there are no real challenges. Well, there are real challenges, but I feel like if you're strong enough, more than strong, if you're consistent enough with your efforts and you don't give up, mm-hmm. those challenges fade away. But the biggest challenge is in the mind. You know, when you believe that you're a woman, when you believe that you're young, and you let that stop you. So I feel it was a lot more conditioning challenge more than actual challenge. Because in the end, when I overcame the conditioning and the boxes and the labels that people put you in, then you just get this innate power to sort of, you know, go through and get through those challenges.
Okay. And then when you're talking about shapes and sizes and the, you know, movement of fabrics, when you talk in the fashion industry, when you see fashion shows in particular, you know, there is a certain body type which is extremely thin, and that's the kind of woman who's, you know, seen to be very fashionable.
Mm.
But what do you think that, why do you think that is? Why do you think we're still doing this?
Mm.
And, you know,
I think those barriers have been broken now.
So?
Yeah. Those barriers, at least in the industry, you know. Mm. I started making things with borders which were anti-fit, oversized in 2011. We're sitting in 2020.
Yeah.
At least I'm hoping that the women who shop from Bodice, at least in my community, maybe I'm in that little safe community that is willing to question, that is willing to push boundaries.
Right.
You're right, maybe in the masses, women still feel those pressures.
Mm-hmm.
But I really don't think there's a need anymore. I think the more you embrace yourself, when I was younger, even I didn't believe it, you know, but the older I grow, I'm like, there is definitely so much more beyond physical beauty, you know. There's
Absolutely.
So much more beyond that. I'm not saying that you shouldn't express yourself with beautiful clothing. But in terms of fashion, I don't really make clothes that are very, you know, sort of fitted.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a personal choice, because
yeah.
I found them very
yeah.
restrictive. You know, I found that they didn't really give space for any growth, or, you know, mm-hmm. it was quite worrying to make clothes like that. Even in terms of design, we try and make sure that it's classic inspired,
mm-hmm.
so you don't get bored of clothes, you know.
So I'm going to play a fashion fire round with you.
Okay.
Quick questions, you can answer as fast as you can.
Okay.
But
okay.
It's a fun round.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Apart from your own brand, which designer or brand do you wear the most often?
I love Comme des Garçons. So Ray Kawakubo and Isimiyaki. This
All
pant
right.
is Isimiyaki. This is Bodice.
Nice. Yeah, that I recognized. Okay. Where one word in fashion you don't like at all?
Trends.
Okay. What would you never ever wear?
Sharara.
All right. One fashion trend that you wish never existed.
Never existed. So many of them, right? Like all of these trends.
Okay. What do you think of fast fashion?
Shouldn't exist.
What's the best part about being a designer?
You just get to create a lot, and also, it's connected with culture, so it's not limited to clothes. I love it that I can dabble with photography, film, architecture, product design, conversations. It really broadens my boundaries and horizons.
Wearing Bodice, what do you want women to feel when they wear your clothes?
Confident. Obviously, I know that's a simple answer, but really secure in themselves. I want them to feel like when they wear Bodice, they should feel confident that they're wearing something which is really hand-picked for them, which is really specially created and curated for them. There are a set of women,
mm-hmm.
power women, not just me, my entire team, that has really looked into to make sure that the garment that you're wearing is specially created for you, keeping in mind the environment, your job, your comfort level. We're trying our best. Of course, it's, you know, a lot,
mm-hmm.
but we try our best to accommodate that, and we want our women to know that. And when they know that and when they wear it, they almost feel well taken care of, and I feel like mostly women are caretakers.
Yes.
So it's nice that they feel like they can buy a garment and they're well taken care of and they feel secure and confident to go conquer the world.
My last question is that you have, again, like I was saying earlier, you've broken a lot of stereotypes. You have, you know, carved your own niche, carved your own path. What would be your advice to the young female Indian designers today?
Again, it's very cliched, but I think the only way to break barriers, and I wasn't even aware I was doing that. It's like women like you, different interviews that made me realize that, yeah, hey, somewhere maybe I've done that. And I think the only way to do it, and it's easier said than done, is to focus on the journey and not in the end, on the end destination, whatever it is, whether it's success, whether it's whatever you're looking out, whatever you're looking for achieving out of that journey. If you're going to focus more on that versus focusing more on the journey, then it'll be hard to break barriers.
But you did have goals, like you did,
of course,
set out things that you wanted to achieve. And
more than goals, I had values. I had values in my mind that this is the product that I want to create, but I didn't really have this urge to have the pace be very fast. Like I knew, or I was reminding myself right from the beginning that I'm not in a race. I'm not running a race. I'm not. If it happens, great. If it doesn't happen, great. You know?
Okay.
I mean, of course, it's nice when you achieve that. Yeah. But it's great not to obsess with the goal or take it very seriously. Because in 10 days, any achievement or failure starts to lose its, you know, pull that it had on you. And I think it's very important to remind yourself that in any profession.
Yeah, because they're young women in college and they are, you know, they're learning to design, whether it's Pearl or whether it's Nif, wherever they are. They're learning to design clothes. Mm. And at that time, you just feel, okay, I need to start my showroom now. It needs to be, you know, in the biggest places. You know, one of the tick marks that, okay, now I'm successful because I showed it like my fashion week or I have a store in Delhi, something like that.
For me, when I was in college, much more than that, when I was in the initial years of Bodice, and even today, every day, I'm only striving to make a better product, have a better story, have better value system, make sure that it's done in the right way. And if you strive towards that, and if you're more obsessed with that versus the goals or the tick marks, they just happen, and they happen much more than you would have thought. You know, even much, because there's so much out there you don't even know, you know. Actually, it's people's job to find you. And this is something I've realized, you know, that actually it's somebody else's job to find a winner, find people to interview, find people to, so they'll do their job if you're doing your job properly. It's not even your job to be showcasing in Lakme Fashion Week or, although those are incredible opportunities. Yeah, of course. But if you have talent, actually there's a full team there looking for you.
Yeah. That's a very nice piece of advice. So thank you so much, Ruchika, for being on the show with us today.
Thank you. I hope I made some sense.
Absolutely, you did. Absolutely. Thank you.